Flip, A California Romance. By Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 2. Chapter 1. Just where the red track of the Los Gatos road streams on and upward like the sinuous trail of a fiery rocket until it is extinguished in the blue shadows of the coast range, there is an embayed terrace near the summit, hedged by dwarf firs. At every bend of the heat-laden road the eye rested upon it wistfully, all along the flank of the mountain, which seemed to pant and quiver in the oven-like air, through rising dust, the slow creaking of dragging wheels, the monotonous cry of tired springs, and the muffled beat of plunging hoofs, it held out a promise of sheltered coolness and green silences beyond. Sunburned and anxious faces yearned toward it from the dizzy, swaying tops of stagecoaches, from lagging teams far below, from the blinding white canvas covers of mountain schooners, and from scorching saddles that seemed to weigh down the scrambling, sweating animals beneath. But it would seem that the hope was vain, the promise elusive. When the terrace was reached it appeared not only to have caught and gathered all the heat of the valley below, but to have evolved a fire of its own from some hidden crater-like source unknown. Nevertheless, instead of prostrating and enervating man and beast, it was said to have induced the wildest exaltation. The heated air was filled and stifling with resinous exhalations. The delirious spices of balm, bay, spruce, juniper, yerba buena, wild syringa, and strange aromatic herbs as yet unclassified, distilled and evaporated in that mighty heat, and seemed to fire with a midsummer madness all who breathed their fumes. They stung, smarted, stimulated, intoxicated. It was said that the most jaded and footsore horses became furious and ungovernable under their influence, wearied teamsters and muleteers, who had exhausted their profanity in the ascent, drank fresh draughts of inspiration in this fiery air, extended their vocabulary, and created new and startling forms of objurgation. It is recorded that one bibulous stage driver exhausted description and condensed its virtues in a single phrase, gin and ginger. This felicitous epithet, flung out in a generous comparison with his favorite drink, rum and gum, clung to it ever after. Such was the current comment on this vale of spices. Like most human criticism, it was hasty and superficial. No one yet had been known to have penetrated deeply its mysterious recesses. It was still far below the summit and its wayside inn. It had escaped the intruding foot of hunter and prospector, and the inquisitive patrol of the county surveyor had only skirted its boundary. It remained for Mr. Lance Harriet to complete its exploration. His reasons for so doing were simple. He had made the journey thither underneath the stagecoach, and clinging to its axle. He had chosen this hazardous mode of conveyance at night, as the coach crept by his place of concealment in the wayside brush, to elude the sheriff of Monterey County and his posse, who were after him. He had not made himself known to his fellow passengers, as they already knew him as a gambler, an outlaw, and a desperado. He deemed it unwise to present himself in his newer reputation of a man who had just slain a brother gambler in a quarrel, and for whom a reward was offered. He slipped from the axle as the stagecoach swirled past the brushing branches of fir, and for an instant lay unnoticed, a scarcely distinguishable mound of dust in the broken furrows of the road. Then, more like a beast than a man, he crept on his hands and knees into the steaming underbrush. Here he lay still until the clatter of harness and the sound of voices faded in the distance. Had he been followed, it would have been difficult to detect in that inert mass of rags any semblance to a known form or figure. A hideous, reddish mask of dust and clay obliterated his face, his hands were shapeless stumps exaggerated in his trailing sleeves. And when he rose, staggering like a drunken man, and plunged wildly into the recesses of the wood, a cloud of dust followed him, and pieces and patches of his frayed and rotten garments clung to the impeding branches. Twice he fell, but, maddened and upheld by the smarting spices and stimulating aroma of the air, he kept on his course. Gradually the heat became less oppressive. Once, when he stopped and leaned exhaustedly against a sapling, he fancied he saw the zephyr he could not yet feel in the glittering and trembling of leaves in the distance before him. Again the deep stillness was moved with a faint sighing rustle, and he knew he must be nearing the edge of the thicket. The spell of silence thus broken was followed by a fainter, More musical interruption, the glassy tinkle of water. A step further, his foot trembled on the verge of a slight ravine, still closely canopied by the interlacing boughs overhead. A tiny stream that he could have dammed with his hand yet lingered in this parched red gash in the hillside and trickled into a deep, irregular, well-like cavity, that again overflowed and sent its slight surplus on. It had been the luxurious retreat of many a spotted trout, it was to be the bath of Lance Harriet. Without a moment's hesitation, without removing a single garment, he slipped cautiously into it, as if fearful of losing a single drop. His head disappeared from the level of the bank, the solitude was again unbroken. Only two objects remained upon the edge of the ravine: his revolver and tobacco pouch. A few minutes elapsed. A fearless blue jay alighted on the bank and made a prospecting peck at the tobacco pouch. It yielded in favor of a gopher, who endeavored to draw it toward his hole, but in turn gave way to a red squirrel, whose attention was divided, however, between the pouch and the revolver, which he regarded with mischievous fascination. Then there was a splash, a grunt, a sudden dispersion of animated nature, and the head of Mr. Lance Harriet appeared above the bank. It was a startling transformation. Not only that he had, by this wholesale process, washed himself and his light drill garments entirely clean, but that he had, apparently by the same operation, morally cleansed himself, and left every stain and ugly blot of his late misdeeds and reputation in his bath. His face, albeit scratched here and there, was rosy, round, shining with irrepressible good humor and youthful levity. His large blue eyes were infantine in their innocent surprise and thoughtlessness. Dripping yet with water, and panting, he rested his elbows lazily on the bank, and became instantly absorbed with a boy's delight in the movements of the gopher, who, after the first alarm, returned cautiously to abduct the tobacco pouch. If any familiar had failed to detect Lance Harriet in this hideous masquerade of dust and grime and tatters, still less would any passing stranger have recognized in this blonde fawn the possible outcast and murderer. And when with a swirl of his spattering sleeve he drove back the gopher in a shower of spray and leaped to the bank, he seemed to have accepted his felonious hiding place as a mere picnicking bower. A slight breeze was unmistakably permeating the wood from the west. Looking in that direction, Lance imagined that the shadow was less dark, and although the undergrowth was denser, he struck off carelessly toward it. As he went on, the wood became lighter and lighter, branches, and presently leaves, were painted against the vivid blue of the sky. He knew he must be near the summit, stopped, felt for his revolver, and then lightly put the few remaining branches aside. The full glare of the noonday sun at first blinded him. When he could see more clearly, he found himself on the open western slope of the mountain, which in the coast range was seldom wooded. The spice thicket stretched between him and the summit, and again between him and the stage road that plunges from the terrace, like forked lightning, into the valley below. He could command all the approaches without being seen. Not that this seemed to occupy his thoughts or cause him any anxiety. His first act was to disencumber himself of his tattered coat. He then filled and lighted his pipe, and stretched himself full length on the open hillside, as if to bleach in the fierce sun. While smoking, he carelessly perused the fragment of a newspaper which had enveloped his tobacco, and being struck with some amusing paragraph, read it half aloud again to some imaginary auditor, emphasizing its humor with an hilarious slap upon his leg. Possibly from the relaxation of fatigue and the bath, which had become a vapor one as he alternately rolled and dried himself in the baking grass, his eyes closed dreamily. He was awakened by the sound of voices. They were distant, they were vague, they approached no nearer. He rolled himself to the verge of the first precipitous grassy descent. There was another bank or plateau below him, and then a confused depth of olive shadows, pierced here and there by the spiked helmets of pines. There was no trace of habitation, yet the voices were those of some monotonous occupation, and Lance distinctly heard through them the click of crockery and the ring of some household utensil. It appeared to be the interjectional, half listless, half perfunctory, domestic dialogue of an old man and a girl, of which the words were unintelligible. Their voices indicated the solitude of the mountain, but without sadness, they were mysterious without being awe-inspiring. They might have uttered the dreariest commonplaces, but, in their vast isolation, they seemed musical and eloquent. Lance drew his first sigh. They had suggested dinner. Careless as his nature was, he was too cautious to risk detection in broad daylight. He contented himself for the present with endeavoring to locate that particular part of the depths from which the voices seemed to rise. It was more difficult, however, to select some other way of penetrating it than by the stage road. They're bound to have a fire or show a light when it's dark, he reasoned, and, satisfied with that reflection, lay down again. Presently he began to amuse himself by tossing some silver coins in the air. Then his attention was directed to a spur of the coast range which had been sharply silhouetted against the cloudless western sky. Something intensely white, something so small that it was scarcely larger than the silver coin in his hand, was appearing in a slight cleft of the range. While he looked, it gradually filled and obliterated the cleft. In another moment the whole serrated line of mountain had disappeared. The dense, dazzling white, encompassing host began to pour over and down every ravine and pass of the coast. Lance recognized the sea fog, and knew that scarcely 20 miles away lay the ocean and safety. The drooping sun was now caught and hidden in its soft embraces. A sudden chill breathed over the mountain. He shivered, rose, and plunged again for very warmth into the spice-laden thicket. The heated balsamic air began to affect him like a powerful sedative, his hunger was forgotten in the languor of fatigue, he slumbered. When he awoke it was dark. He groped his way through the thicket. A few stars were shining directly above him, but beyond and below, everything was lost in the soft, white, fleecy veil of fog. Whatever light or fire might have betokened human habitation was hidden. To push on blindly would be madness. He could only wait for morning. It suited the outcast's lazy philosophy. He crept back again to his bed in the hollow and slept. In that profound silence and shadow, shut out from human association and sympathy by the ghostly fog, what torturing visions conjured up by remorse and fear should have pursued him? What spirit passed before him, or slowly shaped itself out of the infinite blackness of the wood? None. As he slipped gently into that blackness, he remembered with a slight regret some biscuits that were dropped from the coach by a careless luncheon-consuming passenger. That pang over, he slept as sweetly, as profoundly, as divinely, as a child. Chapter 2. He awoke with the aroma of the wood still steeping his senses. His first instinct was that of all young animals. He seized a few of the young, tender green leaves of the yerba buena vine that crept over his mossy pillow and ate them, being rewarded by a half-berry-like flavor that seemed to soothe the cravings of his appetite. The languor of sleep being still upon him, he lazily watched the quivering of a sunbeam that was caught in the canopying boughs above. Then he dozed again. Hovering between sleeping and waking, he became conscious of a slight movement among the dead leaves on the bank beside the hollow in which he lay. The movement appeared to be intelligent, and directed toward his revolver, which glittered on the bank. Amused at this evident return of his larcenous friend of the previous day, he lay perfectly still. The movement and rustle continued, and it now seemed long and undulating. Lance's eyes suddenly became set. He was intensely, keenly awake. It was not a snake, but the hand of a human arm, half hidden in the moss, groping for the weapon. In that flash of perception he saw that it was small, bare, and deeply freckled. In an instant he grasped it firmly, and rose to his feet, dragging to his own level as he did so, the struggling figure of a young girl. "Leave me go," she said, more ashamed than frightened. Lance looked at her. She was scarcely more than 15, slight and lithe, with a boyish flatness of breast and back. Her flushed face and bare throat were absolutely peppered with minute brown freckles, like grains of spent gunpowder. Her eyes, which were large and gray, presented the singular spectacle of being also freckled. At least they were shot through in pupil and cornea with tiny spots like powdered allspice. Her hair was even more remarkable in its tawny deerskin color, full of lighter shades, and bleached to the faintest of blondes on the crown of her head, as if by the action of the sun. She had evidently outgrown her dress, which was made for a smaller child, and the too brief skirt disclosed a bare, freckled, and sandy desert of shapely limb, for which the darned stockings were equally too scant. Lance let his grasp slip from her thin wrist to her hand, and then with a good-humored gesture tossed it lightly back to her. She did not retreat, but continued looking at him in a half-surly embarrassment. "I ain't a bit frightened," she said. "I'm not going to run away, don't you fear."
"Glad to hear it," said Lance, with unmistakable satisfaction, "but why did you go for my revolver?"
She flushed again and was silent. Presently she began to kick the earth at the roots of the tree, and said, as if confidentially to her foot, "I wanted to get hold of it before you did."
"You did, and why?"
"Oh, you know why."
Every tooth in Lance's head showed that he did, perfectly. But he was discreetly silent.
"I didn't know what you were hiding there for," she went on, still addressing the tree, and, looking at him sideways under her white lashes, "I didn't see your face." This subtle compliment was the first suggestion of her artful sex. It actually sent the blood into the careless rascal's face, and for a moment confused him. He coughed.
"So you thought you'd freeze onto that six-shooter of mine until you saw my hand?"
She nodded. Then she picked up a broken hazel branch, fitted it into the small of her back, threw her tanned bare arms over the ends of it, and expanded her chest and her biceps at the same moment. This simple action was supposed to convey an impression at once of ease and muscular force.
"Perhaps you'd like to take it now," said Lance, handing her the pistol.
"I've seen six-shooters before now," said the girl, evading the proffered weapon and its suggestion. "Dad has one, and my brother had two derringers before he was half as big as me." She stopped to observe in her companion the effect of this capacity of her family to bear arms. Lance only regarded her amusedly. Presently she again spoke abruptly.
"What made you eat that grass, just now?"
"Grass," echoed Lance.
"Yes, there," pointing to the yerba buena.
Lance laughed.
"I was hungry."
"Look," he said, gaily tossing some silver into the air. "Do you think you could get me some breakfast for that, and have enough left to buy something for yourself?" The girl eyed the money and the man with half-bashful curiosity.
"I reckon Dad might give ye something if he had a mind ter, though easy a rule he's down on tramps ever since they run off his chickens.
Ye might try.
But I want you to try.
You can bring it to me here."
The girl retreated a step, dropped her eyes, and, with a smile that was a charming hesitation between bashfulness and impudence, said, "So you are hidin', are ye?"
"That's just it.
Your head's level."
"I am," laughed Lance unconcernedly.
"Yer ain't one o' the McCarthy gang, are ye?"
Mr. Lance Harriet felt a momentary moral exaltation in declaring truthfully that he was not one of a notorious band of mountain freebooters known in the district under that name.
"Nor ye ain't one of them chicken lifters that raided Henderson's ranch?
We don't go much on that kind o' cattle yer."
"No," said Lance, cheerfully.
"Nor ye ain't that chap easy beat his wife unto death at Santa Clara."
Lance honestly scorned the imputation. Such conjugal ill-treatment as he had indulged in had not been physical, and had been with other men's wives. There was a moment's further hesitation on the part of the girl. Then she said shortly,
"Well, then, I reckon you can come along with me."
"Where?" asked Lance.
"To the ranch," she replied simply.
"Then you won't bring me anything to eat here."
"What for?"
"You can get it down there."
Lance hesitated.
"I tell you it's all right," she continued. "I'll make it all right with Dad."
"But suppose I reckon I'd rather stay here," persisted Lance, with a perfect consciousness, however, of affectation in his caution.
"Stay away then," said the girl coolly, "only as Dad preempted this yer woods."
"Preempted," suggested Lance.
"Preempted or preempted, as you like, continued the girl scornfully, easy he's got a hold on this year woods, ye might easy well see him down dar easy here. For here he's like to come any minute. You can bet your life on that. She must have read Lance's amusement in his eyes, for she again dropped her own with a frown of brusque embarrassment. Come along, then, I'm your man, said Lance, gaily, extending his hand. She would not accept it, eyeing it, however, furtively, like a horse about to shy. Hand me your pistol first, she said. He handed it to her with an assumption of gaiety. She received it on her part with unfeigned seriousness, and threw it over her shoulder like a gun. This combined action of the child and heroine, it is quite unnecessary to say, afforded Lance undiluted joy. You go first, she said. Lance stepped promptly out, with a broad grin. Looks kinder as if I was a prina, don't it? He suggested. Go on, and don't fool, she replied. The two fared onward through the wood. For one moment he entertained the facetious idea of appearing to rush frantically away, just to see what the girl would do, but abandoned it. It's an even thing if she wouldn't spot me the first pop, he reflected admiringly. When they had reached the open hillside, Lance stopped inquiringly. This way, she said, pointing toward the summit, and in quite an opposite direction to the valley where he had heard the voices, one of which he now recognized as hers. They skirted the thicket for a few moments, and then turned sharply into a trail which began to dip toward a ravine leading to the valley. Why do you have to go all the way round? He asked. We don't, the girl replied with emphasis, there's a shorter cut. Where? That's telling, she answered shortly. What's your name? Asked Lance, after a steep scramble and a drop into the ravine. Flip. What? Flip. I mean your first name, your front name. Flip. Flip. Oh, short for Felipa. It ain't Flipper, it's Flip. And she relapsed into silence. You don't ask me mine, suggested Lance. She did not vouchsafe a reply. Then you don't want to know. Maybe Dad will. You can lie to him. This direct answer apparently sustained the agreeable homicide for some moments. He moved onward, silently exuding admiration. Only, added Flip, with a sudden caution, you'd better agree with me. The trail here turned again abruptly and re-entered the canyon. Lance looked up, and noticed they were almost directly beneath the bay thicket and the plateau that towered far above them. The trail here showed signs of clearing, and the way was marked by felled trees and stumps of pines. What does your father do here? He finally asked. Flip remained silent, swinging the revolver. Lance repeated his question. Burns charcoal and makes diamonds, said Flip, looking at him from the corners of her eyes. Makes diamonds, echoed Lance. Flip nodded her head. Many of them, he continued carelessly. Lots. But they're not big, she returned, with a sidelong glance. Oh, they're not big, said Lance gravely. They had by this time reached a small staked enclosure, whence the sudden fluttering and cackle of poultry welcomed the return of the evident mistress of this sylvan retreat. It was scarcely imposing. Further on, a cooking stove under a tree, a saddle and bridle, a few household implements scattered about, indicated the ranch. Like most pioneer clearings, it was simply a disorganized raid upon nature that had left behind a desolate battlefield strewn with waste and decay. The fallen trees, the crushed thicket, the splintered limbs, the rudely torn up soil, were made hideous by their grotesque juxtaposition with the wrecked fragments of civilization, in empty cans, broken bottles, battered hats, soleless boots, frayed stockings, cast-off rags, and the crowning absurdity of the twisted wire skeleton of a hoop skirt hanging from a branch. The wildest defile, the densest thicket, the most virgin solitude, was less dreary and forlorn than this first footprint of man. The only redeeming feature of this prolonged bivouac was the cabin itself. Built of the half-cylindrical strips of pine bark, and thatched with the same material, it had a certain picturesque rusticity. But this was an accident of economy rather than taste, for which Flip apologized by saying that the bark of the pine was no good for charcoal. "I reckon Dad's in the woods," she added, pausing before the open door of the cabin. "Oh, Dad." Her voice, clear and high, seemed to fill the whole long canon, and echoed from the green plateau above. The monotonous strokes of an axe were suddenly intermittent, and somewhere from the depths of the close-set pines a voice answered Flip. There was a pause of a few moments, with some muttering, stumbling, and crackling in the underbrush, and then the appearance of Dad. Had Lance first met him in the thicket, he would have been puzzled to assign his race to Mongolian, Indian, or Ethiopian origin. Perfunctory but incomplete washings of his hands and face, after charcoal burning, had gradually ground into his skin a grayish slate pencil pallor, grotesquely relieved at the edges, where the washing had left off, with a border of a darker color. He looked like an overworked Christie minstrel with the briefest of intervals between his performances. There were black rims in the orbits of his eyes, as if he gazed feebly out of unglazed spectacles, which heightened his simian resemblance, already grotesquely exaggerated by what appeared to be repeated and spasmodic experiments in dyeing his gray hair. Without the slightest notice of Lance, he inflicted his protesting and querulous presence entirely on his daughter. "Well, what's up now? You're calling me from work an hour before noon. Dog my skin, if I ever get fairly limbered up afore it's Dad, and oh, Dad." To Lance's intense satisfaction the girl received this harangue with an air of supreme indifference, and when Dad had relapsed into an unintelligible, and, as it seemed to Lance, a half-frightened muttering, she said coolly, "Ye'd better drop that axe and scoot round gettin' this stranger some breakfast and some grub to take with him. He's one of them San Francisco sports out here trout fishing in the branch. He's got adrift from his party, has lost his rod and fixins, and had to camp out last night in the gin and ginger woods. That's just it, it's allers suthin' like that," screamed the old man, dashing his fist on his leg in a feeble, impotent passion, but without looking at Lance. "Why in blazes don't he go up to that there blamed hotel on the summit? Why in thunder but here he caught his daughter's large, freckled eyes full in his own." He blinked feebly, his voice fell into a tone of whining entreaty. "Now, look here, Flip, it's playing it rather low down on the old man, this you're running in o' tramps and desart emigrants and cast ashore sailors and forlorn widders and ravin lunatics, on this your ranch. I put it to you, mister," he said abruptly, turning to Lance for the first time, but as if he had already taken an active part in the conversation, "I put it as a gentleman yourself, and a fair-minded sportin' man, if this is the square thing." Before Lance could reply, Flip had already begun. "That's just it? Do you reckon, being a sportin' man and a one feller, he's goin' to waltz down inter that hotel, rigged out easy he is? Do you reckon he's goin' to let his partners get the laugh onter him? Do you reckon he's goin' to show his head outer this your ranch till he can do it square? Not much. Go long. Dad, you're talking silly." The old man weakened. He feebly trailed his axe between his legs to a stump and sat down, wiping his forehead with his sleeve, and imparting to it the appearance of a slate with a difficult sum partly rubbed out. He looked despairingly at Lance. "In course," he said, with a deep sigh, "you naturally ain't got any money. In course you left your pocketbook, containing $50, under a stone, and can't find it? In course," he continued, as he observed Lance put his hand to his pocket, "you've only got a blank check on Wells, Fargo and Company for $100, and you'd like me to give you the difference." Amused as Lance evidently was at this, his absolute admiration for Flip absorbed everything else. With his eyes fixed upon the girl, he briefly assured the old man that he would pay for everything he wanted. He did this with a manner quite different from the careless, easy attitude he had assumed toward Flip. At least the quick-wit girl noticed it, and wondered if he was angry. It was quite true that ever since his eye had fallen upon another of his own sex, its glance had been less frank and careless. Certain traits of possible impatience, which might develop into manslaying, were coming to the fore. Yet a word or a gesture of Flip's was sufficient to change that manner, and when, with the fretful assistance of her father, she had prepared a somewhat sketchy and primitive repast, he questioned the old man about diamond making. The eye of Dad kindled. "I want ter know how ye knew I was making diamonds," he asked, with a certain bashful pettishness not unlike his daughter's. "Heard it in Frisco," replied Lance, with glib mendacity, glancing at the girl. "I reckon they're getting sort of skeered down there, them jewelers," chuckled Dad, "yet it's in nater that their figures will have to come down. It's only a question of the price of charcoal. I suppose they didn't tell you how I made the discovery." Lance would have stopped the old man's narrative by saying that he knew the story, but he wished to see how far Flip lent herself to her father's delusion. "Yes, see, one night about 2 years ago I had a pit o' charcoal burning out there, and though it had been a smoldering and a smoking and a blazing for nigh unto a month, somehow it didn't charcoal worth a cent. And yet, dog my skin, but the heat o' that ER pit was suthin' hideous and frightful, ye couldn't stand within 100 yards of it, and they could feel it on the stage road 3 miles over yon, t'other side the mountain. There was nights when me and Flip had to take our blankets up the ravine and camp out all night, and the back of this here hut shriveled up like that bacon. It was about as nigh onto hell as any sample ye can get here. Now, mebbe you think I built that air fire? Mebbe you'll allow the heat was just the natural burning of that pit." "Certainly," said Lance, trying to see Flip's eyes, which were resolutely averted. "That's where you'd be lying. That yar heat came out of the bowels of the earth, came up like out of a chimblay or a blast, and kept up that yar fire. And when she cools down a month after, and I got to strip her, there was a hole in the earth, and a spring o' bilin, scaldin' water pourin' out of it easy big as your waist. And right in the middle of it was this yer." He rose with the instinct of a skillful raconteur, and whisked from under his bunk a chamois leather bag, which he emptied on the table before them. It contained a small fragment of native rock crystal, half fused upon a petrified bit of pine. It was so glaringly truthful, so really what it purported to be, that the most unscientific woodman or pioneer would have understood it at a glance. Lance raised his mirthful eyes to Flip. "It was cooled sudden stunted by the water," said the girl, eagerly. She stopped, and as abruptly turned away her eyes and her reddened face. "That's it, that's just it," continued the old man. "Thar's Flip, thar, knows it, she ain't no fool." Lance did not speak, but turned a hard, unsympathizing look upon the old man, and rose almost roughly. The old man clutched his coat. "That's it, yessie. The carbon's just turning to dim ends. And stunted. And why? 'Cause the heat wasn't kept up long enough. Mebbe yer think I stopped thar? That ain't me. Dar's a pit out yar in the woods easy been burning 6 months, it hint, in course, got the advantages o' the old one, for it's natural heat. But I'm keeping that heat up. I've got a hole where I can watch it every 4 hours. When the time comes, I'm thar. Don't you see? That's me. That's David Fairley, that's the old man, you bet." "That's so," said Lance, curtly. "And now, Mr. Fairley, if you'll hand me over a coat or jacket till I can get past these fogs on the Monterey Road, I won't keep you from your diamond pit." He threw down a handful of silver on the table. "There's a deerskin jacket yer," said the old man, "that one o' them vaqueros left for the price of a bottle of whiskey." "I reckon it wouldn't suit the stranger," said Flip, dubiously producing a much worn, slashed, and braided vaquero's jacket. But it did suit Lance, who found it warm, and also had suddenly found a certain satisfaction in opposing Flip. When he had put it on, and nodded coldly to the old man, and carelessly to Flip, he walked to the door. "If you're going to take the Monterey Road, I can show you a short cut to it," said Flip, with a certain kind of shy civility. The paternal fairly groaned. "That's it, let the chickens and the ranch go to thunder, as long as there's a stranger to traipse round with, go on. Lance would have made some savage reply, but Flip interrupted. You know yourself, Dad, it's a blind trail, and as that air constable that came out here hunting French Pete, couldn't find it, and had to go round by the cannon, like easy not the stranger would lose his way, and have to come back. This dangerous prospect silenced the old man, and Flip and Lance stepped into the road together. They walked on for some moments without speaking. Suddenly Lance turned upon his companion. You did n't swallow all that rot about the diamond, did you? He asked, crossly. Flip ran a little ahead, as if to avoid a reply. You don't mean to say that's the sort of hogwash the old man serves out to you regularly, continued Lance, becoming more slangy in his ill temper. I don't know that it's any concern o' yours what I think, replied Flip, hopping from boulder to boulder, as they crossed the bed of a dry watercourse. And I suppose you've piloted round and dry-nussed every tramp and deadbeat you've met since you came here, continued Lance, with unmistakable ill humor. How many have you helped over this road? It's a year since there was a Chinaman chased by some Irishman from the crossing into the brush about yer, and he was too afeard to come out, and nigh most starved to death in thar. I had to drag him out and start him on the mountain, for you couldn't get him back to the road. He was the last one but you. Do you reckon it's the right thing for a girl like you to run about with trash of this kind, and mix herself up with all sorts of roughs and bad company, said Lance. Flip stopped short. Look, if you're going to talk like Dad, I'll go back. The ridiculousness of such a resemblance struck him more keenly than a consciousness of his own ingratitude. He hastened to assure Flip that he was joking. When he had made his peace they fell into talk again, Lance becoming unselfish enough to inquire into one or two facts concerning her life which did not immediately affect him. Her mother had died on the plains when she was a baby, and her brother had run away from home at 12. She fully expected to see him again, and thought he might sometime stray into their cannon. That is why, then, you take so much stock in tramps, said Lance. You expect to recognize him. Well, replied Flip, gravely, there is something in that, and there's something in this, some o' these chaps might run across brother and do him a good turn for the sake of me. Like me, for instance, suggested Lance. Like you. You'd do him a good turn, wouldn't you? You bet, said Lance, with a sudden emotion that quite startled him. Only don't you go to throwing yourself round promiscuously. He was half conscious of an irritating sense of jealousy, as he asked if any of her proteges had ever returned. No, said Flip, no one ever did. It shows, she added with sublime simplicity, I had done em good, and they could get on alone. Don't it? It does, responded Lance grimly. Have you any other friends that come? Only the postmaster at the crossing. The postmaster? Yes, he's reckoning to marry me next year, if I'm big enough. And what do you reckon? Asked Lance earnestly. Flip began a series of distortions with her shoulders, ran on ahead, picked up a few pebbles and threw them into the wood, glanced back at Lance with swimming mottled eyes, that seemed a piquant incarnation of everything suggestive and tantalizing, and said, That's telling. They had by this time reached the spot where they were to separate. Look, said Flip, pointing to a faint deflection of their path, which seemed, however, to lose itself in the underbrush a dozen yards away, there's your trail. It gets plainer and broader the further you get on, but you must use your eyes here, and get to know it well afore you get into the fog. Goodbye. Goodbye. Lance took her hand and drew her beside him. She was still redolent of the spices of the thicket, and to the young man's excited fancy seemed at that moment to personify the perfume and intoxication of her native woods. Half laughingly, half earnestly, he tried to kiss her. She struggled for some time strongly, but at the last moment yielded, with a slight return and the exchange of a subtle fire that thrilled him, and left him standing confused and astounded as she ran away. He watched her lithe, nymph-like figure disappear in the checkered shadows of the wood, and then he turned briskly down the half-hidden trail. His eyesight was keen, he made good progress, and was soon well on his way toward the distant ridge. But Flip's return had not been as rapid. When she reached the wood, she crept to its beetling verge, and looking across the canyon, watched Lance's figure as it vanished and reappeared in the shadows and sinuosities of the ascent. When he reached the ridge, the outlying fog crept across the summit, caught him in its embrace, and wrapped him from her gaze. Flip sighed, raised herself, put her alternate foot on a stump, and took a long pull at her two brief stockings. When she had pulled down her skirt and endeavored once more to renew the intimacy that had existed in previous years between the edge of her petticoat and the top of her stockings, she sighed again, and went home. Chapter 3. For 6 months the sea fogs monotonously came and went along the Monterey coast. For 6 months they beleaguered the coast range with afternoon sorties of white hosts that regularly swept over the mountain crest, and were as regularly beaten back again by the leveled lances of the morning sun. For 6 months that white veil which had once hidden Lance Harriet in its folds returned without him. For that amiable outlaw no longer needed disguise or hiding place. The swift wave of pursuit that had dashed him on the summit had fallen back, and the next day was broken and scattered. Before the week had passed, a regular judicial inquiry relieved his crime of premeditation, and showed it to be a rude duel of two armed and equally desperate men. From a secure vantage in a seacoast town, Lance challenged a trial by his peers, and, as an already prejudged man escaping from his executioners, obtained a change of venue. Regular justice, seated by the calm Pacific, found the action of an interior, irregular jury rash and hasty. Lance was liberated on bail. The postmaster at Fisher's Crossing had just received the weekly mail and express from San Francisco, and was engaged in examining it. It consisted of 5 letters and 2 parcels. Of these, 3 of the letters and the 2 parcels were directed to Flip. It was not the first time during the last 6 months that this extraordinary event had occurred, and the curiosity of the crossing was duly excited. As Flip had never called personally for the letters or parcels, but had sent one of her wild, irregular scouts or henchmen to bring them, and as she was seldom seen at the crossing or on the stage road, that curiosity was never satisfied. The disappointment to the postmaster, a man past the middle age, partook of a sentimental nature. He looked at the letters and parcels, he looked at his watch, it was yet early, he could return by noon. He again examined the addresses, they were in the same handwriting as the previous letters. His mind was made up, he would deliver them himself. The poetic, soulful side of his mission was delicately indicated by a pale blue necktie, a clean shirt, and a small package of ginger nuts, of which Flip was extravagantly fond. The common road to Fairley's ranch was by the stage turnpike to a point below the gin and ginger woods, where the prudent horseman usually left his beast and followed the intersecting trail afoot. It was here that the postmaster suddenly observed on the edge of the wood the figure of an elegantly dressed woman. She was walking slowly, and apparently at her ease, one hand held her skirts lightly gathered between her gloved fingers, the other slowly swung a riding whip. Was it a picnic of some people from Monterey or Santa Cruz? The spectacle was novel enough to justify his coming nearer. Suddenly she withdrew into the wood, he lost sight of her, she was gone. He remembered, however, that Flip was still to be seen, and as the steep trail was beginning to tax all his energies, he was fain to hurry forward. The sun was nearly vertical when he turned into the canyon, and saw the bark roof of the cabin beyond. At almost the same moment Flip appeared, flushed and panting, in the road before him. "You've got something for me," she said, pointing to the parcel and letter. Completely taken by surprise, the postmaster mechanically yielded them up, and as instantly regretted it. "They're paid for," continued Flip, observing his hesitation. "That's so," stammered the official of the crossing, seeing his last chance of knowing the contents of the parcel vanish, "but I thought easy it's a valuable package, maybe ye might want to examine it to see that it was all right afore ye receipt for it." "I'll risk it," said Flip, coolly, and if it ain't right I'll let ya know. As the girl seemed inclined to retire with her property, the postmaster was driven to other conversation. We ain't had the pleasure of seeing you down at the crossing for a month o' Sundays, he began, with airy yet pronounced gallantry. Some folks let on you was keepin' company with some feller like Bijah Brown, and you were getting a little too set up for the crossing. The individual here mentioned being the county butcher, and supposed to exhibit his hopeless affection for Flip by making a long and useless divergence from his weekly route to enter the cannon for orders, Flip did not deem it necessary to reply. Then I allowed how easy you might have company, he continued, I reckon there's some city folks up at the summit. I saw a mighty smart, fashionably gal cavorting round. Had no end o' style and fancy fixins. That's my kind, I tell you. I just weaken on that sort o' gal, he continued, in the firm belief that he had awakened Flip's jealousy, as he glanced at her well-worn homespun frock, and found her eyes suddenly fixed on his own. Strange I ain't got to see her yet, she replied coolly, shouldering her parcel, and quite ignoring any sense of obligation to him for his extra-official act. But you might get to see her at the edge of the gin and ginger woods, he persisted feebly, in a last effort to detain her, if you'll take a passeer there with me. Flip's only response was to walk on toward the cabin, whence, with a vague complimentary suggestion of drop in to pass the time o' day with her father, the postmaster meekly followed. The paternal fairly, once convinced that his daughter's new companion required no pecuniary or material assistance from his hands, relaxed to the extent of entering into a querulous confidence with him, during which Flip took the opportunity of slipping away. As Fairley had that infelicitous tendency of most weak natures, to unconsciously exaggerate unimportant details in their talk, the postmaster presently became convinced that the butcher was a constant and assiduous suitor of Flip's. The absurdity of his sending parcels and letters by post when he might bring them himself did not strike the official. On the contrary, he believed it to be a masterstroke of cunning. Fired by jealousy and Flip's indifference, he deemed it his duty using that facile form of cowardly offensiveness to betray Flip. Of which she was happily oblivious. Once away from the cabin, she plunged into the woods, with the parcel swung behind her like a knapsack. Leaving the trail, she presently struck off in a straight line through cover and underbrush with the unerring instinct of an animal, climbing hand over hand the steepest ascent, or fluttering like a bird from branch to branch down the deepest declivity. She soon reached that part of the trail where the susceptible postmaster had seen the fascinating unknown. Assuring herself she was not followed, she crept through the thicket until she reached a little waterfall and basin that had served the fugitive lance for a bath. The spot bore signs of later and more frequent occupancy, and when Flip carefully removed some bark and brushwood from a cavity in the rock and drew forth various folded garments, it was evident she used it as a sylvan dressing room. Here she opened the parcel, it contained a small and delicate shawl of yellow China crepe. Flip instantly threw it over her shoulders and stepped hurriedly toward the edge of the wood. Then she began to pass backward and forward before the trunk of a tree. At first nothing was visible on the tree, but a closer inspection showed a large pane of ordinary window glass stuck in the fork of the branches. It was placed at such a cunning angle against the darkness of the forest opening that it made a soft and mysterious mirror, not unlike a Claude Lorraine glass, wherein not only the passing figure of the young girl was seen, but the dazzling green and gold of the hillside, and the far-off silhouetted crests of the coast range. But this was evidently only a prelude to a severer rehearsal. When she returned to the waterfall, she unearthed from her stores a large piece of yellow soap and some yards of rough cotton sheeting. These she deposited beside the basin and again crept to the edge of the wood to assure herself that she was alone. Satisfied that no intruding foot had invaded that virgin bower, she returned to her bath and began to undress. A slight wind followed her, and seemed to whisper to the circumjacent trees. It appeared to waken her sister naiads and nymphs, who, joining their leafy fingers, softly drew around her a gently moving band of trembling lights and shadows, of flex sprays and inextricably mingled branches, and involved her in a chaste sylvan obscurity, veiled alike from pursuing God or stumbling shepherd. Within these hallowed precincts was the musical ripple of laughter and falling water, and at times the glimpse of a lithe briar caught limb, or a ray of sunlight trembling over bright flanks, or the white austere outline of a childish bosom. When she drew again the leafy curtain, and once more stepped out of the wood, she was completely transformed. It was the figure that had appeared to the postmaster, the slight, erect, graceful form of a young woman modishly attired. It was Flip, but Flip made taller by the lengthened skirt and clinging habiliments of fashion. Flip freckled, but, through the cunning of a relief of yellow color in her gown, her piquant brown shot face and eyes brightened and intensified until she seemed like a spicy odor made visible. I cannot affirm that the judgment of Flip's mysterious modiste was infallible, or that the taste of Mr. Lance Harriet, her patron, was fastidious, enough that it was picturesque, and perhaps not more glaring and extravagant than the color in which Spring herself had once clothed the sere hillside where Flip was now seated. The phantom mirror in the tree fork caught and held her with the sky, the green leaves, the sunlight and all the graciousness of her surroundings, and the wind gently tossed her hair and the gay ribbons of her gypsy hat. Suddenly she started. Some remote sound in the trail below, inaudible to any ear less fine than hers, arrested her breathing. She rose swiftly and darted into cover. 10 minutes passed. The sun was declining, the white fog was beginning to creep over the coast range. From the edge of the wood Cinderella appeared, disenchanted and in her homespun garments. The clock had struck, the spell was past. As she disappeared down the trail, even the magic mirror, moved by the wind, slipped from the treetop to the ground, and became a piece of common glass.